Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Step up to the microphone, please.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the freedoms and privileges that we enjoy as citizens of this great nation. And we ask, Lord, for your protection upon our land. Tonight, we lift up this meeting of the county commissioners and all our government officials and offices and ask, Lord, that we be guided by mercy, justice, and faith, that all people within our borders and beyond enjoy the liberty of life, free from fear, evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves. I give you thanks, Lord, tonight for these servants who come before you to serve you and the people of our nation, the people of our county, in this way. And I just ask your guidance upon them, Lord. Be with us. May our hearts and minds be open, that we may hear one another and share in the governing of our great nation, even in this form of merely our county, Lord, for it begins here with us and spreads throughout the world when we are open to one another. And I thank you, Lord, for this privilege to come before you tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Reverend Jenny Neal of Hall River Methodist Church, thank you.
I'd like to welcome each and everyone to our meeting tonight. This is the part of the meeting where people sign up for public comments. And we have three that have signed up. We'll start with the first one is Sterling Holt, Jr. Mr. Holt?
Yes, you can come forward.
Yes, sir.
First of all, thank you for allowing me to come before the Board of County Commissioners tonight. I just would like to make a special appeal to the board to consider the West End section of Mebane when making decisions involving the CBDG grant, the program focusing on community revitalization, the housing rehabilitation program, and scattered housing sites, and, as well as housing rehab. Thank you for allowing me to share these thoughts with you, and hope you will take this in consideration. Have a great evening.
Thank you, Mr. Holt.
Thank you. And we will have a public hearing in just a moment on that particular matter. Next is Beverly Kerr. Ms. Kerr?
Thank you. I'm Beverly Kerr. I'm with the Be Safe, Not Sorry Community Action Group, and I'm here tonight to ask for your help with a proposal that's going to be presented here pretty soon. The Environmental Management Commission is proposing to make permanent an exemption in the state's health protective toxic air pollutant limits. This will allow any plant in North Carolina that burns unadulterated pure fossil fuel or wood as a combustion source. It gives them permission to pollute our air, water, land, and health. Emissions from these combustion sources account for the second largest source of emissions from industrial plants that burn this type of fuel. If made permanent, the ruling would give approximately 1,400 sources of industrial pollution, coal-fired power plants, paper mills, asphalt plants, and thousands of other smokestacks in North Carolina an open door to pollute. Toxic air pollutants from these combustion sources include mercury, a neurotoxin. Airborne particles become methyl mercury taken up in fish, linked to learning disabilities and mental retardation in children. Arsenic, a presumed human carcinogen linked to lung and skin cancer. Chromium, linked to respiratory problems, kidney and liver damage. Cadmium, a human carcinogen linked to renal dysfunction in men and women. Hydrogen chloride, forms hydrochloric acid on contact with body tissue, linked to inflammation of nose, throat, and upper respiratory tract. Dioxins, there is no safe level of dioxins, a known human carcinogen that accumulates in the food chain and linked to birth defects, learning disabilities, reproductive disorders, and attention deficit disorder in children. It's bad enough that these toxic substances have been allowed to go unchecked in our environment. It's even worse that they will continue to go completely unregulated if this exemption is made permanent. Please make your voices heard. Please support a resolution that approves the removal of this exemption. Let the EMC know that these toxic emissions need to be regulated. I've enclosed a little information for you with the addresses and phone numbers and emails of the people to contact, and also the website of the North Carolina Division of Air Quality where you can get more details. There's also a list of the facilities in Alamance County that would be affected.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Curry. The last one on the list is Hannah Gill. Ms. Gill?
Good evening, Commissioners. How are y'all doing this evening?
Good.
I'm Hannah Gill. I'm a resident of Southern Alamance County, and I'm here tonight on behalf of Fairness Alamance, which is a group of local residents who have come together to promote respectful treatment for all residents of our county. And we're just curious, we wanted to check up on the status of the conversations about the provisions for the Memorandum of Understanding between for the 287G program, between the agreement between the Sheriff's Department and ICE, that require, number one, a steering committee for the oversight of 287G, and also the complaint mechanism for those who've been arrested under the program. We basically just want more information about that. And in general, the provisions of the MOA just to better inform the larger community. So 2 months ago, we've had conversations. 2 months ago, there was talk about addressing this in a month or two, and we're just wondering where we are at that point, and if you could update us on the current status. So that's just a question. So thank you very much.
Okay. We did answer some of the questions that were submitted to us on our website. They've been on the website now for about 2 or 3 weeks, I guess. There is not a citizens committee that's been formed. There is a committee that has to be formed with the implementation of the 287G, and that's basically with the Sheriff's Department and other officials affiliated with that. I don't know if Sheriff wants to explain that a little bit more in detail, what type of committee is now functioning.
We have a local steering committee made up of the ICE, federal ICE people, our people in Alamance County Jail. But there is an executive steering committee set up in the state of North Carolina that's made up of the SBI, Attorney General's Office, ICE, Sheriff's Association, and Senator Doyle even had a lady sit on that committee too. And I don't know what's going to happen now, but it's about a 20-man and woman committee that oversees the entire operation of every 287G in sight in the state, and we now have seven. Our orders and directions come from them, and then it's double checked by the local steering committee to make sure we are enforcing. We even have times that people come out of Atlanta and come up and sit down and review everything we have ever done in the 287G program.
Thanks, sir.
Thanks, sir.
Okay, next we will go into our.
Excuse me, sir. Yes. Tell us more about the complaint.
We do have complaint mechanisms in the memorandum of understanding it, and I sent probably 15-20 copies of memorandum of understanding to people that have requested. I don't recall seeing any of y'all in my office. I'll be glad to give you one.
I have a copy. I was just curious, what's the mechanism by which someone who's been arrested can make a complaint?
We have a grievance procedure that goes up the ladder and inevitably winds up in the federal authorities' hands if it's a problem to investigate. But it's all set out in the every inmate comes in is given a handbook, grievance procedures of how they, if they want to file a grievance, and where it goes and how it's handled.
it's all in hand. Be glad to, like I say, if you'll come see me, I'll be glad to give you everything we've got, but none of you have ever come to my office. I wish you would, to sit down and let's discuss what's going on.
Can I ask one more question about the oversight committee? Is there a possibility that people who are not in the sheriff's department could be part of some sort of committee so that there's more transparency, so that the rest of the community understands?
Before the memorandum of understanding was signed, we had to set up an in-house steering committee. Every one of these commissioners seen what was in the memorandum of understanding. And then the executive committee was formed by the state, just about every agency, federal, all the way in Washington, D.C., right on down. I don't know, I mean, you're willing to come and look at our program, you're willing to monitor our program, whatever you want. But I don't see no sense in setting up three or four committees. I'll just be honest with you.
Thank you. Next, we have a public hearing on the Community Development Block Grant Program. Jason.
Good evening, Commissioners. As you may or may not be aware, annually we are required to hold a public hearing regarding the Community Development Block Grant Program and the different grants that are applied for the new year. Before we can actually apply for any grants. As you know, in the past, we've applied for several community development block grants. Most recently, an infrastructure grant that we're using over off of Flora Avenue right now, which that project is underway, and they are beginning to put in the sewer line now as we speak. Also, we have done two hookup grants, infrastructure hookup grants, and we also intend to apply for an additional one this year, provided that we have enough intent or interest among citizens in the county, and that is also on the consent agenda tonight to set the public hearing for that. But there are a number of other things. These funds can be used. They're intended to be used to help low to moderate income citizens to extend improvements in infrastructure for water and sewer, also for housing development, for housing rehabilitation, and other projects of the sort. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time. And I would also say that Mr. Holt, that spoke during the public comment section, I have noted that and will include that in my report to the grant administrator on this meeting as well.
Okay.
Just answered my question. Thank you.
Are there any other public comments on the CDB block grant? If not, we'll close the public hearing. And we will, in the consent agenda, set up another public hearing for the hookup grant application. When is that going to be?
I'm glad you asked. I have in the request for the next meeting, and I know from the previous meeting it was expressed that it would be best to have these meetings at night. In this particular case, we really need to have that public hearing scheduled for the first meeting in December, and that is solely so that we are able to apply for the grant. Without that, then we would automatically be disqualified. So,
okay. Could I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the feasibility of Mr. Holt's request for CDBG?
I am somewhat aware of the West End needs that are there. They've had a very well-organized association there that has worked diligently on their infrastructure needs, particularly water and sewer. I would need to get basically an update as to what's going on there. It has been a little while since I've had anything on that. So,
okay. Any other questions? Okay, thank you, Jason.
Appreciate it.
Next, Assistant County Manager Tim Burgess on the Gov Deals program.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, good evening. I have the privilege this evening of introducing Rebecca Murphy, who is a sales representative with Gov Deals out of their Charlotte office. She's going to come and do a presentation on what Gov Deals is, but a little introduction to this. This is an internet-based program which basically gives local governments another mechanism in which to sell their surplus property. In the past, we have basically taken all of our surplus property that we accumulate throughout the year and carry it over to Burlington for a sale over there. haven't had great success in the past. A lot of it, to be honest with you, for lack of a better term, is junk. However, there is a market for junk out there, but it happens to be on govdeals.com and not at our local sales. So she's going to talk a little bit about that tonight. When she concludes her presentation, I'll come back up here. There's if the commissioners, the board is interested in approving us moving forward with this project, there'll be two items that you'll need to approve, which is a resolution and authorize us to enter into a contract with their company. So at this time, I introduce Rebecca Murphy.
Do a short presentation. This presentation compares what you've been doing, traditional live auctions, to what GovDeals does, GovDeals auctions. So we're going to run through this real quick, and then we're going to take a brief look at the GovDeals auction site. Okay. Traditional live auctions are held local. Primarily, they have a local audience, more so with gas prices. So the audience is limited, and that means lower auction values are typically obtained. There are weather factors. You compete with yourself on duplicate assets. There is the potential for buyer collusion. What that means is that they go view the items and then they go have coffee and say, let's don't compete against each other. You know, you take these two cars and I'll take these two. And that happens often with live auctions. Surplus must be moved to one location for a live auction, and you are competing with other local auctions and events. Typically, they're held annually, semi-annually, quarterly, or monthly, so there is a delayed movement of assets, which is a loss of time value of money. Depreciation, deterioration, things have to be stored in some type of a facility until the auction occurs. Often, items are cannibalized for their parts, and there is a lot of movement of items required, which is puts you at risk for workers' compensation claims. The overhead or direct cost associated with a live auction are the auctioneer percentage. Typically, an auctioneer will also collect a buyer's premium at the time things are paid for. There's generally lots of overtime involved in getting prepared for an auction. There's overtime on the auction date. There's the need for security, and there's the cost of advertising. Okay. Other factors of a traditional live auction, these are indirect overhead costs, labor costs to move items to and from storage, storage facility cost, utilities, rent, cleaning, security, etc., depending on what type of facilities you use, dedicated employee costs sometimes to deal with the surplus, and again, money is tied up in unused and depreciating assets, so you're losing time value of money. Okay. GovDeals online auctions, it increases the item exposure. There's a much larger audience, which creates more competition and higher sale prices. There are focused buyers who are specifically interested in the type of things that governments surplus. There's an international audience to compete for your obsolete items. There's a diverse and innovative audience. It's amazing what these people plan to do with some of this stuff that you don't even, you can't imagine anyone would even want. They have big plans for it. There's the ability to sell unusual and high value items that again wouldn't have a local audience at your local auction typically. And items are exposed to bidders for an extended time frame. Reduces your overhead because storage requirements are reduced or eliminated. There's the ability to auction items as is, where is. So if a piece of equipment breaks down, you just auction it right where it's sitting when it breaks down. You don't move it around. There's no overtime involved since auctions occur on your schedule. There's no advertising or upfront cost. GovDeals has a marketing department that takes care of, we actually run ads on your surplus items. We actually produce press releases and work with you on those, announcing to your public that you're going to be using us as an option for some of your surplus property. So we work with you to satisfy all of that. There is no cost for unsold items. So if you put something out there that indeed turns out to be so much of a piece of junk that no one wants it, you have an auction trail, an audit trail showing that you did attempt to auction the item, so you've got a complete audit trail on the item, and you've satisfied your requirement to try to auction it, but you do not owe us anything on that. We only charge on successfully auctioned items. And with our auction service, the buyer picks up or transports items. Everything, again, is sold as is, where is, with the buyer responsible for removal of the items. Okay? You get higher returns, first of all, because items are auctioned while they're at their maximum surplus value, which is as soon as they become surplus property. Also, they're not subject to damage, cannibalization, or deterioration. There is no opportunity for collusion. You cannot stop people from bidding on an internet auction site. So there's no way that there can be buyer collusion. We have very focused buyers. We do a lot of marketing efforts to make sure that we go after focused buyers. We join a lot of associations like the Scrap Dealers Association, the Funeral Directors Association for Incinerators, you know, et cetera, the types of things that we typically auction on our site. We have gone out and found the right buyers for those type of items. And it accelerates the process of returning money for surplus property to your budget. Okay, for the bidders, it's also an advantage. The bidders have 24/7 access to auction items. They can be watching the ball game and bidding on the internet. You know, they can be up at 3 o'clock in the morning bidding on your items. It gives them the ability to easily and inexpensively locate items, so they're willing to pay more for things because the upfront cost of locating those items is reduced. They have the ability to place automatic bids. So, for example, if you went on our site and you looked at a vehicle and you knew that the most you'd be willing to pay for that vehicle was $2,000, you could go on ahead and place a $2,000 bid, even if at this time it's at $100, and the system would just bid for that bidder. And at the point that someone quit competing against them, it would stop. If it was below the $2,000, then they would be the winning bidder. If it was over the $2,000, they would not be the winning bidder. They would no longer be part of the auction at the point that it exceeds their automatic bid. So it has that efficiency. It gives the bidders time to do research on items and gives them time to notify others of item availability. It gives them time to access the funds to purchase those items, and it gives them time to make pickup and storage arrangements. So it is an advantage also to the bidders. Okay, here are some statistics. I note that you were provided with a copy of this presentation, and you'll notice that these statistics are different than what are in your that you were given. Stuart and I have been talking for about 4 months, and I have had repeatedly, he contacted me 4 months ago, and every time I would send him a presentation, they would have different statistics because we are growing very fast. This last presentation I decided I gave him 2 weeks ago, and when I came here tonight, I had to update the figures because we are growing. We are at 2,050 total government clients. Over $206 million in surplus, abandoned, and confiscated property has been auctioned on our site. Over $22.8 million auctioned here for North Carolina governments. $7.7 million auctioned in North Carolina just this year. We have 280 North Carolina clients. We just got a new one today, Seven Devils, North Carolina. That one's too small to be a GovDeals client. And we have 61 North Carolina County clients. Vance County came with us last week. So these are our statistics. And here's how we charge for our service. We charge a percentage of what you get for the item. And as items are worth more, our percentage reduces. So 7.5% of the first $100,000 of what you would get for an auctioned item with the reduction schedule. We bill you the first of the month following the sale with 30-day terms, which means you never pay us upfront money. You always pay us out of collected auction proceeds. So there is no upfront cost for using GovDeals. Okay, now I would love to show you our site just so I can, Okay, let me try. It reduced down to a, let me see if I can get to it this way. Let's see again. That was someone else's presentation. Okay. A little technical difficulty.
That's old Graham High School.
Okay. Back behind here, we should have our site. There we go. This is the GovDeals site. If you were to type in www.govdeals.com, this is what you would come to. This is what the bidders see. And you'll notice that these are all categories of items that are currently out there. These are all government items that are out there. If someone wanted to always know what was available, they could go every morning to Latest Online and look at everything that's been put on the site in the last 24 hours. Or if they were interested in looking at things that were about to close, auctions, they could go there. There also is the ability to do a zip code search. So if you wanted to stay within a 100 or 200 mile radius of your home to do your shopping, you could actually do a zip code search. There's the ability to do an advanced search. So if you wanted to look only in North Carolina, for example, or you wanted to look at all of the Crown Vicks on our site, for example, you could do that with an advanced search. And there's also the ability to look at past auction results. And this is really powerful, and this is what I want to show you real quick, because this gives you an opportunity to forecast what you might get for items on our site and to see items that have successfully auctioned on our site. When you go to past auction results, it defaults to 14 days, but you can push it down to a year. If you wanted to, for example, just look in North Carolina, just a second, let it refresh itself. I pulled down a year's worth of data, and that's quite a bit of data, so it takes a minute to refresh itself. If we wanted to look at everything that had auctioned within North Carolina in the last year, we would have the ability to do that. 8,061 items have auctioned here in North Carolina in the last year. So that is one way that the past auction results could be used. Or if we specifically wanted to look at a North Carolina seller, we could actually look at a category if there's a category of items you wanted to look at. Or you could just type Crown Vic right here, a short description of the item. So there is the ability for you to go look at items that have already auctioned on the site and do a little due diligence on us. So that's a pretty powerful tool when you're doing your forecasting. These are all the columns that currently have things in it. One of the most interesting columns to look at, we always encourage governments to look at us as a way to create revenue, perhaps from things that you did not think of as revenue resources. Look at all the water meters that are being auctioned on our site. They're being auctioned for the scrap metal value in those. So a lot of governments at one time maybe got a dollar or two a piece for their water meters from the people who were putting in their new meters or from their local scrap dealer. They're now getting to compete and to sell these to international and national buyers on our auction site. There also is the ability even to take scrap piles, for example, and this looks like it could be a scrap pile. This is what an auction, it looks like pipes out there, and it's taken a minute to load the pictures. But, you know, all it takes is photographs of the items. You leave them where they are, you take photographs of them, you put the photographs out on an internet site. Your terms and conditions are always attached to the item, and these are the terms and conditions that have been drawn up by an attorney to protect you. So these have to be accepted by each bidder. So the safeguards have been built into the program, and the intention is for you to use this as a way to reduce the overhead on your requirement to do an auction process for your surplus, and to use this as an opportunity to make additional money from your surplus property, and also to auction things that you've not typically thought of as opportunities for revenue. One of my North Carolina governments I work with recently, they were expanding a park, and they bought some land to expand the park, and it had two brick homes on it, older 1960 vintage brick homes. They received bids to demolish the homes. It was going to cost them about $15,000 total to demolish the two houses. Instead, they auctioned them off the site, with the successful bidder having to demolish and remove everything associated with the houses from the site, and they netted about $20,000 ahead by doing that. So Burke County used us to, they acquired an old textile mill, and they used us in the renovation of that textile mill with what they made in the auctions and what they saved in their original bid to remodel the old Dobbins mill. They came out about $187,000 ahead by using our auction site. So those are just some examples, and I'd welcome any questions you might have.
I have a question.
Okay.
How would John Public be able to bid on a site, on an item that they saw on there?
Okay. There is, for one thing, what we're going to want to do is to work with y'all to do a press release here locally that would have, hopefully, some quotes from you guys telling your citizens that you're going to be using GovDeals as an option if y'all elect to go that way, and explaining to them how to register to become a bidder on the site. They would go to the site, and there's actually a place to register. I'll go back to the home page, and I'll show that to you real quick. Here's new bidder registration is right here. They register for free. The registration process is just an information validation process. No financial information is required. They have to give us a valid email address, physical address, and telephone number, and we actually do verify those three pieces of information because we want to make sure they're a legitimate individual with good intentions to bid on your things on your this site, and also with the intention to pay for the items to carry through on that. So we do validate the bidders. It's also one strike, you're out. If someone does not pay for something that they win in an auction, if they default on it, they're locked from the site. So that's the registration process. Anyone can register and be a bidder on GovDeals, and we also provide a link for your website that would go. It does not go directly to our homepage. It goes directly to a special page for you for Alamance County. And if you do not have anything available, it just says nothing available. It's not an advertisement for GovDeals in general. It's only an advertisement for your surplus, and it does appear. Generally, it'll be on the purchasing page of your website or something, and you know, so you can instruct your local citizens to go there and to see what you have for sale.
That was my next question.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
How many registered bidders do you have now?
Our parent company has several companies. They have one company that has a Department of Defense contract. They have another division that has contracts with big box stores like Best Buy and those folks when people return things. They have GovDeals, and then they have one other foreign company, and together we have over 1 million bidders. The bidders that are unique to GovDeals, I think the last count I saw was we were just under 150,000 unique only to GovDeals that registered through GovDeals, but there are links between the sites. And so your stuff has a huge audience if you put it on GovDeals, and that's the key, is to increase your exposure so you can hopefully make more money on it. Additional questions?
There's certainly a lot of counties and cities making a lot of money off of this, and it does broaden the scope of.
And it's people. Not, we don't require a contract. You don't get married to us. We just have a simple agreement that I think Mr. Burgess is going to ask you to allow the county to sign. So you can still use other methods as well as GovDeals. You know, this doesn't have to be your only method. It's an option for you as it makes sense. And you're just positioning yourself to be able, hopefully, to have us as an option. Okay. You can use it as much or as little as you want. Okay. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Just to clarify an earlier statement, not all of our stuff is junk, but, you know, one man's junk is another man's treasure. So anyway, two items need you to approve if you'd like to move forward with this program. First thing is a resolution which prescribes the procedures for electronic auction disposal of surplus property valued at less than $30,000. You do have that resolution in your agenda packet, and it gives you the details of that. That basically allows us to sell items electronically by adopting that resolution. The second item is a contract. Allows County to contract with GovDeals to be able to place items on their webpage. It doesn't cost us anything unless they sell the item. It also does not. We can use other means to sell surplus property. However, once we do post something on their page, that's the only way we can sell it. We can't be trying to sell that same item in two different locations or by two different means. But it does not. It doesn't cost us anything unless we do use our services. So. And if we don't want to use our services, we can just don't have to use them, and we don't have to pay them anything. So
it looks to me like it's a win-win situation for the taxpayers of Alamance County.
I think so, because if you look at what they've been able to get selling items versus probably what we've been able to get in the past, we're going to see an increase in revenue based on what we can sell on GovDeals versus what we've been able to sell at local auction.
Who else do we allow to sell items during our auction? Do we the fire departments and
I'm not sure
City of Burlington.
Who's with the City of Burlington? City of Burlington, and we go in with them. I'm not sure the other any other organization.
There's other surrounding cities, and they do it's about four or five people that participate with the City of Burlington with their auction.
But I mean,
if it's done by Teague Auction for the last 3-4 years, that's who's been handling.
And if our volunteer fire departments had excess property, could they sell it through our website?
Yes, sir. They can either set up their own account or they can work with you. Only it has to be owned by government to be on our side. But we have a lot of volunteer fire departments that work with us.
Okay. And you just get that word out, too.
Okay. And just want to know, we've been paying typically between 5% and 15% at the local auction. And, of course, this is going to be a 7.5% at the most.
We have a motion.
So moved.
Exactly. Are we the motion to approve both the resolution and the contract?
Both. Both.
Okay. Second. Second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you,
TJ. Next is the Elon Library announcement. Ms. Cobb.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Thank you for your support of the new public library being planned in the town of Elon. I'm pleased to report that after several months of discussion, the site decision for the new library has been finalized. The Board of Aldermen voted last week to choose the Beth Schmidt Park location for the new library. In Alamance County, we are very fortunate to have a dedicated group of volunteers who work very hard to support public library programs and activities. This wonderful group of library supporters are the Friends of Alamance County Public Libraries. If there is anything extra special going on at any of our libraries, you can be assured that the Friends of the Library are behind that program. At this time, I'd like to introduce the president of the Friends of Alamance County Public Libraries, John Stubblefield.
Thank you, Jude. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Each year, the Friends of the Library hold two book sales, one in the spring and another in the fall, to raise funds to support the Alamance County Libraries. Thanks to our many volunteers, our book sales have been extremely successful. The mission of Friends is to promote the interest of Alamance County Public Libraries and to extend and improve library services to our community. In keeping with our mission, I'm here tonight to advise you that the Friends Board has agreed to donate $50,000 for the purchase of books, CDs, and DVDs for the new Western Library. Tonight with me, Deanna Manning. I'd like to introduce Deanna Manning and also Patsy Pringle, they're both on our board and they've worked on the fundraising for the new Western Library. I offer a further thanks to those who have donated books and those who buy them so that we may continue to support the Alamance County Libraries. Thank you very much for the time.
Thank you. That's a very generous group. Thank you.
Could I ask a question about the building? What's the time frame of completion?
There is not a time frame now. I know that they're ready to go forward now that this
site has been finalized, and in selecting an architect, we do have a building program that has been completed through the $15,000 LSTA grant that we were able to get through the state library. So we have a written definition of the library space that we need for that new library. So also some for mm-hmm. now.
But
hopefully 2010.
Okay, that's what I'm getting ready to ask. Okay. Trying to think about a budget.
Did I see Ms. Cobb where it's predicted that's going to be maybe the busiest library in the county?
That's my personal prediction.
Okay.
Biggest used.
Yeah.
Next, we have the county manager's reports. Dave?
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, several things. One, of course, you have before you the finances of the county for the first 3 months of this fiscal year. It's one with the yellow stripe across the top of it. And basically, the county looks like it's in pretty good shape. You'll notice the revenues are the main things we've been concerned about through this budget year. And you'll see the actual note column for 2007 and 2008. We're up about $3.5 million on revenues this year over last year. So we're in pretty good shape, but quite frankly, I don't want to lift any of the restrictions that we have put on until the six-month period is up. Amy and I think that at that time, we'll know a little bit more about where we stand for the final 6 months of the year. But as it looks right now, the first 4 months, we're a little better than we were the first quarter also. So the month of October helped us out a lot. We don't know whether the sales tax revenues are going to stay up like they have so far. Again, come the end of December, I think you'll have a better judgment as to where we stand revenue-wise. But it looks good right now. And I think with the strict restrictions that we do have, kind of a tight grip on it, will help for a while. So, and let me point out one thing. I think one of the reasons we are doing better than some of the other counties and cities is that we budgeted very conservatively this year. We even lowered our estimates as to what the sales tax would be. And your budget, I think, is holding up pretty good. Amy agrees with that. And I think if we stay conservative, watch our spending, we'll be all right for the rest of the year.
What's the lag time in sales tax?
2 months.
2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why we wonder whether it's going to hold up after the first of the year. Secondly, it was not long ago that the board purchased some land down south for the expansion of our landfill. Part of that purchase of land was a house and about 1.8 acres, I think, around that house that the landowner owned, and the board gave him a life estate in that. Some of his family is trying to purchase that particular part, which is of no interest to the county and does not interfere with with what the landfill and the county would be doing with the largest tract of land. Mr. Ingold himself, not the Ingold that we purchased the property from, but I believe it's a cousin.
Yes, sir.
Is here, and he'd like to ask the board to consider selling him that because of his dairy farm is divided, and he needs a lot of that property to conduct his dairy farm business, and the county has always been very supportive of our dairy farms. Let me remind the county that, and Mr. Ingold knows this also, if the board is willing to sell it, it would have to be advertised and would have to be sold at public auction. And anybody could bid on it at that time. Stingle, I think, has something he'd like to present to you. And we have a picture, I think, if we can get it up, of the tract of land that he's talking about.
You have
from
the
Where you put this up your ass?
The property line is right beyond these trees, mm-hmm. and this here is on the property line right here, mm-hmm. where the our young stuff are raised at, and all the way over here. Now our cows also cross over here to our other cousin's property, mm-hmm. and they have for years, you know, to go across there for feed and shelter and stuff.
And 12 foot of this building's on that property too.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah. You'll see on the map on the screen here the property that Mr. Engel is talking about. Right. And it juts out from the large tract that the county now owns, and really the county has no use for that. We bought it because it was all in the package, but and we needed the 100 and some acres down across from the landfill. But we don't really need that tract of land. It's up to the board what you'd like to do with it. But Mr. Engel does have a vested interest in that property for his farm.
And we've spoken to Mr. Engel, who has the life estate.
Yes, sir.
And he's willing and agreeable.
My understanding, there are no problems within the family at all, and it will be sold subject to his life estate. If it's sold at all, it'll be subject to his life estate. Yes, sir.
Yeah, let me.
I think we've got farmers helping out. Eight dairy farms left in the county right now.
13.
That's 13. Thank you, Mr. Cobb. And you're looking at an operation that produces 5,500 pounds of milk a day. Yes. And we don't need to lose any more dairy farms.
There's several farmers here, commissioners, also in support of Mr. Engel.
Okay, David, this would
thank you.
Mr. Engel, would the county set a minimum bid?
Yes, sir. It started, I believe, at $55,000.
$55,000.
Yes, sir.
And you can put this on your electronic website if you like.
I don't know if we want to do this.
I don't think that'd be a good idea.
Any commissioners have any questions of Mr. Engel?
I don't have a question. I just think it's a shame that we have to put it out to bid. I don't see why he just can't fight that.
I feel the same way, Commissioner Vaughn. I went out there and spent about an hour and a half with the Engels and looked it over, and I mean, it's just such a vital part of that dairy farm. They're talking about it's right there where they keep the yearling heifers before, you know, they turn them to where they're dairy cows, and then you've got one building, and maybe two. One building, I know, it's 12 foot over the line. I think another one's also over the line, so it's just a vital part of that operation. Thank you.
Okay, do we have a motion?
Move.
I have a motion and
second.
A second. There's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Okay, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. Next, Mr. Chairman, I would ask the board if you would pass a motion for a closed session pursuant to Chapter 143-318.11a. 5 for the consideration of purchasing some property, different property.
Okay, do we have a motion to go in closed session?
Before we do, can we talk about a topic that might be more efficient? Some people might want to leave and not wait on us to come back. Something I'd like to talk about.
Yeah, why don't we go ahead and we'll finish the agenda and then come back to it. Okay, next is the consent agenda. There's no opposition. I'll make a motion that we approve items A through E on the consent agenda. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, all in favor of the consent agenda say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay, any announcements? Tim, you got something?
Right. And Tom, I'm glad you're here. I want to ask you to help me with something, or maybe if you can get something back to us. Soon. The Alamance News did a story last Thursday about the history of the average daily membership in our schools from 1979, 1980 to 2007, 2008. And this is just for information, for my information. I knew that there had been some fluctuation in ADM, but I didn't realize that back in 1979, 1980, that we had roughly 20,000 students in our schools, if these figures are correct. That would just be 2,300 shy of what we've got in there today. And from that date, 1979, 1980, it dropped from 19.9 steadily all the way down until it hit 16.371, and that was roughly 10 years later. And then it's grown, gone back up to 22.2. Now, what I'm trying to inquire about is capacity of our schools. I don't know of a school that's been torn down that we didn't replace, like Smith and Hillcrest. I mean, those 19,900 students were in seats in 1979, 1980, I assume. I wasn't here. I moved over here in 1983, came back in 1983. But The county staff has provided a total bond referendum sheet here from 1992, 93, 95 bonds, 2006 bonds. They total $98 million. And the numbers of schools that we've added on to, and there's a couple here that I'm questioning that it looks like an addition, but it's not spelled out. I've got like 18 out of 30-some schools having been added on to. Plus, we've added two new elementary schools online without closing one that I know of. A middle school online without closing one. Hillcrest was, of course, built to replace the old Hillcrest, and I assume it's larger than the old Hillcrest. And Smith, the same situation. The classrooms, not counting those new schools, the classrooms that I see that we've added, according to this report, is 82 classrooms. Plus, those new schools, and I'm not sure how many modulars we used back then when we had 19,900 students. My question is has capacity numbers, in other words, you know, I've heard for years that years ago Williams' capacity would be X amount of students. Now it's another figure. Cummins, the same thing, and so forth. And I assume that could be true at all the schools. And I know that we're using certain rooms in some of our schools that could be used for classrooms, or maybe were used for classrooms. We're using for something else now. I'm not being critical of that. I'm just saying that I think that's probably part of it. And you've got smaller classes you're trying to address and so forth. I guess what I'd like to ask, when can we get a full accounting of the full capacity of all the plants that are online, and then a separate figure of how many mobiles that we're using?
And we can provide that. As you indicated, over time, class sizes have become smaller. We also have different needs of classrooms today than we did when we had the peak numbers for special education classes. We've got a lot of different media centers now that we may not have had there in their scope. But the quick answer to your question is we can provide that information, and I'll be happy to follow up and get someone to get with you all on that.
Yeah. And I'm not trying to be negative here other than to say it appears that going back to 1979 to 1980, we had 20,000 students roughly, if these figures are correct. We've only got 2,000 some odd students more now. How many years later is that? Almost 30 years later, 28 years later. But we've added, it appears, I'd be willing to say we've probably added over 4,000 seats. So, you know, I'm trying to see where the seats went,
sure,
so to speak, where the capacity has gone. If we can get a handle on that, because I'm sure the new board starts next week, 2 weeks from now, or first meeting in December, you know, we're going to be hit with new school capital needs requests.
Yeah, and our board also will be reflected in new membership during that same time, and we are looking at the same type of information, growth projections, where is the growth going to be,
right,
what are our facilities. So I think we're both interested in looking at the same thing.
Right.
What is the average class size now, Tom? Do you know?
Well, it depends on the grade, and I'll defer to my wife. The elementary school is supposed to be 20 students in the elementary through third, and then fourth and fifth, it goes up to 20, 30.
It can go to third.
And then and then it raises up from that point. But the class size initiative at the state level has primarily been at the elementary level.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Any other announcements? Tonight, I'll make a motion that we go into closed session to discuss the possible purchase of property. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? The motion carries.
Is there a